Welcome back to Sunday Morning Quickies, episode 98 for the 1st of October, 2023. We're going to be back at the bench this week for Sunday Morning Quickies, and we're going to put the main shaft and the vertical shaft back into the 66-1. I'm going to do the demonstration on that. But before we do, before we roll that tape, there's a couple of tools I want to show you and some supplies that I think you guys are going to like. Those of you who are viewers of my friend Jen's channel, Sewing Machine Rehab, have seen her use these pliers. These are the IPS PH-200 soft-nosed slip joint pliers, and you'll see that they have actually two different openings in the end and an opening in the tip and really nice nylon jaws. These are the 200 millimeter versions. There's also a 165 version, and they're like normal slip joints except they are soft jawed. Very, very nice. Extremely comfortable grips. I didn't know about these until I watched one of Jen's recent videos and I saw her using these to extract the needle bar out of a machine. And I was like, ooh, ooh, ooh. And she put a link to these on Amazon. I went ahead and I ordered a set, and oh my God, are these great. I must caution you, however, if you buy these, don't just clip the little zip ties on the card and throw the card away, because inside the card, packaged in there, is a spare set of the soft jaws and the screws that secure them. Do not throw that card away. File it someplace safe, so in the event you need to, or the eventuality that you have to change that, not those soft jaws out, if they get damaged, you don't lose it. Not being one to leave well enough alone, I went back on Amazon and I found these. These are the IPS SH-1655. These are the, 165S. These are the 165 millimeter slip joint needle nose pliers. These are wicked cool as well. They also have some wire lines inside the jaws to assist in bending wire. They're also spring-loaded, not heavily spring-loaded, but mildly spring-loaded, and they are slip joint needle nose. When have you ever found slip joint needle nose? Now, like their regular slip joint counterparts, don't throw out the card, because yes, inside, right there, a spare set of jaws with the little tiny springs that you will never find anywhere else. Can guarantee you that. So anyway, yeah, those both go into my pile of cool stuff. People have asked for years now, Bob, where do I find fiber washers that can go in on the moving mass on the armature of my potted motor? Haven't found any. Hadn't found any that were suitable until now. And down below in the doobly-doo, I will have the part numbers for you. I found these. I got them both at McMaster Car. Let me get my notes here. The gray ones, although both of them actually have an inside diameter that is 312 thousandths. So it's a little bit sloppy, a little bit of a sloppy fit, not overly sloppy on the shaft itself, but they fit and they work. The outside diameter fits and works with the bearing surfaces on the motor. The gray ones range between 14 and 16 thousandths inch thick, and the red ones are between 28 and 34 thousandths thick. So if you need fiber washers so that you can adjust the position of the armature inside the machine, inside the motor, so that the brushes are hitting in the right spot, they're available. Now, how much do they cost? Well, they're only in available in bags of 100. Okay, you might not do a lot of motors, and 100 might be more than you want to normally keep around. It's not going to break the bank. 100 of the grays, the 14,000s to 16,000s thick, are $2.62. Ooh, it's going to break the bank. And 100 of the reds is $3.74. Links down in the description below. Once again, McMaster Car is not a sponsor. I don't get kickbacks. I don't get any kind of money from them. This is just stuff that I have spent money on, I have found that works, and I'm letting you know. Now, there's something else you're going to be interested in, especially those of you who are working on machines in bent wood cases. If you're working on a machine, say a 99 or a 128 that's in a bent wood case, many times, depending upon the knee controller you've got, if the system used Chicago plugs, you'll find there's two holes in the metal plate. This is the plate that rests on the far right-hand side of the lower portion of the bentwood case. Well, if you're converting a machine over, converting the wiring over, and you don't want to use the Chicago plugs anymore, say you're hardwiring in a power cord down below, and you're still stuck with the big gaping holes here. Well, one option you have is to find an appropriate size grommet, easy enough to do. Actually, Harbor Freight has a grommet assortment. It is this rubber grommet set, and it actually has a grommet that will fit that application. But what do you do about the other gaping hole? Here's what you do about it. I found these, once again, from McMaster Car. These little plastic caps that can snap in and fill the hole quite nicely. It's a snap fit, not a problem. You're not altering anything. Put a grommet on the other side, snap one in here, then you can run your wires out through the grommet that's going to your knee bar controller or whatever setup you're doing. Or if you're completely eliminating the knee bar controller, you can take these, two of these, and trim one edge off so it looks like that. Trim it on both of them. Go ahead, snap them in the hole. Say line them up and snap them in the hole, and voila, you filled the holes up and it looks really, really nice. So where do you get these? Once again, these I found at McMaster Car. They're nylon snap-in plugs. The link will be down below. These are the 5/8 inch inner diameter black. A pack of 100 will set you back $15.01. Now, if you don't do a lot of this stuff, I can understand, but for those of us who collect, those of us who service them, I know I'm never going to be without having at least 50 of, my reorder point will be when I drop down to about 30 or 40. I will try to always keep at least 50 of these on hand. Likewise, these washers, I'm going to, once I hit like the 30 or 40 point, I will order another 100 of these washers. We're not talking a tremendous amount of money for these things, but they're pretty cool. Now, I did look at some other washers. The unique three-pronged lock washer that's used to hold the stitch length regulator in, I found a couple of different washers that I'm experimenting with. And if I find something that I'm happy with, I'll report back on that later. But these I wanted to let you know about now. Okay, let's take a look at that 66-1 going back together again. The original plan for this machine was what I had wanted to do is I was going to polish her down really well and shine her up. The owner of the machine knows the condition of the decals, that there's a lot missing here in the front, some missing from the bed, and they're getting a little faded in other spots, and she's kind of happy with the patina. And after I started cleaning her off with sewing machine oil, I discovered that her clear coat's really badly compromised, and if I took a polisher to this to try to polish her up, I'm going to damage these decals, so I'm not going to polish her, at least not by machine. I will, after she's pretty much back together, I'll take the auto glim to her. There's no sense in doing it now because she's only going to get filthy in the process of reassembly. So what I'm going to start with is I'm going to chase some threads on some of these holes where things didn't want to come out very easily. I'm starting up here with the 7/16 by 28 tap, chasing out the threads at the presser foot adjuster up here on the top. I'm just going to run the tap down here. It feels a little gritty, so it's obvious she needs her threads cleaned out. And that's clearing up now, so I'm going to knock that crap out, run this down a little bit further, clean the stuff off the tap, and bring her back out. And there's a couple of others that I want to do as well. That obviously being an important one, because that's an important adjustment that you're using quite often. So we get the crud out of there. I'm going to clean out my tap before I put it back in its case. All right, next up, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my 1028 tap, and I'm going to tap the hole for the spool pin, because we use threaded spool pins, and I've got nothing in the machine right now, so I got nothing to worry about as far as filings going anywhere. So we're just going to thread that hole. And that feels good. Out. And we'll test for the spool pin. Perfection. All right. Add the spool pin to the parts bin for this machine. And that's all I'm going to worry about right at the moment. We have some more tapping to do, but that's going to happen when we get to the bottom of the machine. And we'll clean those. We'll chase those back then. All right, now I have cleaned the vertical shaft and the main shaft, the pivot points, and the pivot points here. Here's the vertical shaft. Here's the main shaft. Here's the cam and the screw for the vertical shaft, the tight adjusting screw. So what we're going to do at this point now is we're going to put the vertical shaft and the main shaft back into this machine. So first thing we have to do is we have to put the upper pivot point in. So let me swing this around. Now the upper pivot point goes inside and it's going to come from the inside. It's going to get popped in. So I'm going to drop that down to that position. Oops, let me swing this around. Let me readjust the camera here real quick. All right, I'm going to put that pivot point right into its hole right here. Get it started. And then I'm going to take a wooden mallet hammer, just tap it down a little bit. And then, if I can find where I put my dowel, here it is. I'm going to take my long wooden dowel, set it on there. I'm doing this one-handed. This is not the smartest thing I've ever done. And just use my mallet and tap it down the rest of the way. This is gentle taps, kids. We're not wailing on this. Gently tapping it until it goes down and seats, just like that. That is seated. All right, now I'm going to put the vertical shaft back in from the top. Kind of have to jockey it around a little bit to get it in position. And I'm going to get her down there and sitting on that pivot point. Okay, you can see how it's sitting on that pivot here. I'll lift it up so you can see. You see where the pivot is down there. Now, the pivot bolt, the pivot screw, I should say, I'm going to put in from the top here and get started. Let me get a sizable screwdriver for this. This one here will do. Just get that started. And then I'm going to have to hold the vertical shaft so that the pivot point in the vertical shaft is lined up as I screw this back down. And there, it just kind of, the point went. There we go. Now I've got the adjusting nut very, very loose. And you can see here, there we go. Set this down. You see how that's real stiff? That's not what we want. So I'm going to back that screw off just a touch, and there we go. And if I go to rattle it, there's just a little rattle there, so I'm going to put it in just a touch. There we go. And I drop my screwdriver. So we have nice and free motion, and what I'm going to do now is very carefully, I'm going to hold that screw with the screwdriver and move the nut up so it's just starting to touch the casting. There we go. Double check. Still nice and free. So now I'm going to hold the screw. Oops. Oops, use the right size. The 11/16 is what I want. I'm going to hold the screw with the screwdriver. Snug that. Just the way I want it. All right. Oopsie. There. Perfect. So that's all there is to getting that vertical shaft in. We don't need that 11/16 wrench anymore, so that can get back into the drawer. Now, getting the main shaft back in. Main shaft is going to come in through the nose of the machine. Things we have to be aware of. First of all, there's this set screw here. I'm just going to go ahead and pull this set screw out all the way. I don't want it being a bother, so that's out of the way now. This flat on the nose bushing is going to be up against that set screw. This hole here is going to line up with this lubrication hole on top. As we're putting the main shaft into the machine, we have to be cognizant of the orientation of this flat
before we drive that bushing home. Now, I did clean the inner portion of this really, really well, and we're going to lubricate that a bit. But we still have to be very, very conscious of where everything is going here. Let me put this set screw someplace where it'll be a little bit safer. There we go. And then, of course, we have to get the cam oriented correctly. So let me come up with a better camera angle than this, and we'll tackle this next part of the problem. Okay, when we put the cam back on the main shaft, you'll note at the where the dog leg is here in the shaft, there's this area that's ground. Where that area is ground, that's where, when the cam goes on, the set screw is going to go into that ground area. That's going to lock in the feed timing. It's very important to get that correct. Also, when it goes on, the area that's not the cam surface itself, the fat area, is going to go pointed towards the needle bar. So this will be up against, well, not against, because we don't want to touch, but it'll be going towards the vertical shaft. So this is a little tricky. I'm going to try to do this with multiple camera shots so you can see what we're doing here. I'm going to start by making sure that the vertical shaft is pretty much pointing forward, so that the opening is pointing forward. Now I'm going to take the main shaft and insert it into the front hole and get it so that it's inside the cage. And it is now... Okay, I've got the main shaft so that it's in the cage. Let me bring the camera down. Okay, you can see now, this is the hardest part, is getting the cam back on the main shaft. So I'm going to scooch the cam on, not worrying about its final orientation just yet, but getting the cam on the main shaft. There we go. And then raising the main shaft and getting it started in the hole where it comes out the back of the machine. All right, I've got it started there. All right, now we can look forward at the cam and see what the cam is doing. All right, I've got the hole in the actually, let me get a little bit more oil in there. And I just put some oil on this cam, or on this bearing. There we go. So get it nice and slick. And I'm getting that lined up so that I can press that in. And then slowly move the main shaft back in place. And press the whole mechanism right into the casting. Back a little bit further. Okay, I need to tap that in ever so gently. Have we seated? Not quite seated yet. Getting close. We're not quite seated yet. I'm gonna give it a couple more little taps. That sounds like it's seated. Yes, that's seated. So before we go too far, I'm going to grab the set screw that goes up front. And get that back into the machine. I want to double check to make sure my alignment is going all the way down. Yes, my oil port is lined up. I'm going to tighten the set screw. There we go. That lined up with our oil port. Okay. We got that part done. Now, the next tricky part is working down in here. And we've got to get this set screw on the cam, where my finger is, into that slot here, which will line up the cam correctly. Let me try to change the camera angle a little bit. I now have screw starter in the set screw, and you can see I've got it pretty much lined up, and I'm just going to run that in a little bit here. So now the set screw is in that groove. So we're going to have that alignment correct. What needs to happen next is two things. We need to make sure that the cam is in the correct position on the shaft, meaning that it's not too close to the vertical shaft, so it's not banging into things. We want good clearance there. It looks like that's going to clear at that point. I'm just going to snug it a little, not tightening it up all the way. All right, now that I've got that, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to put the stop motion bushing back on. Let me change the camera shot for you. Okay, this is this particular stop motion bushing is one that's secured with a screw. So what I need to do is I need to line up the screw hole on the main shaft with the appropriate hole on the stop motion bushing. I'm going to do that by looking down from the top. Oh, look at that. It just slipped right on and it's perfect. I'm going to go ahead and put the securing screw in place. Come on. There we go. Get a beefier screwdriver on there. And there we go. There you have it. So, we're not done yet. We're going to turn her around and we're going to make the final adjustments on the cam position and make the adjustments to the cage for the vertical shaft. Now that we have the stop motion bushing on, we can check for our clearances here for the vertical shaft and the cam. But first thing we're going to do is we're going to get this screw started back in. And you see this, I'm going to hold the shaft. You see this rattling that we have in the cage of the vertical shaft? That's what this screw is going to take care of the adjustment for. So I'm going to very gently... Okay, I've got the screw so it's seated. Now, let's see. We still have rattling. So I'm going to just tighten just a little bit. I'm going to see what that does. Still rattling a touch. Tighten just a little bit more. I'm going to go a quarter of a turn here. Still a little bit of rattle. There we go. There's just a touch of rattle in there. Get a little bit more of that out. You have to be very careful. Here's another opportunity to break that cage on the vertical shaft. And there we go. I'm not going to try to take any more of that out. What's there is minuscule. Maybe just a touch. Just a touch. And that's usually, when I say taking out just a touch, that's famous last words 90% of the time. I'm going to take just an eighth of a turn more. Not even. It's not going to let me go. So we're going to live with that. We have good clearance between the cage and the cam. So I'm going to just move that cam a little bit farther forward. See if it'll let me. You see there, there's no clearance. So we want to get so that there's just a little bit. And there you go. It's not hitting. And it looks like it's going to behave itself. We'll get some oil in there and lubricate that up. I'm going to get some oil up here with that in the middle position, and that'll help lubricate that. Some oil here on that bearing, oil on that bearing. Whoops, made a mess. Okay. Now you remember what this looked like when I started, and I think you'll remember, because I know a lot of you commented on it when I was taking it apart, and I used the electric drill to spin the shaft once I had this bushing off. But, yeah. So anyway, that's as far as we're going to go on this today for this episode. I think that's enough, and we'll move right along.
Before we go, today is actually Saturday night, the 30th of September. Liz and I, it's been a busy week for us. Last night, or actually all day yesterday, was a bit of a whirlwind trip. We left the house at around 8:30 in the morning in driving rain. If you're looking at this in the well into the future, this is the storm that dumped about 8 inches onto New York City, and the subways flooded, and New York was a mess. But here in Jersey, there was a lot of flooding, and the visibility while driving sometimes was like 50 feet. Anyway, we headed out 8:30 in the morning up the Garden State Parkway to pick up the New Jersey Turnpike, went down, picked up the Pennsylvania Turnpike, went out to York, Pennsylvania, and met viewer Tammy and her husband Matt for lunch at the Round the Clock Diner in York, PA. Tammy and Matt were coming up from North Carolina to go to a family event about 2 hours away from there, but we had a couple of sewing machines for Tammy. We had a 15-90 and a Model 99 for Tammy's program that she's starting up, teaching homeschoolers and homeschool kids how to do sewing, sewing-related things, either basic sewing skills or whatever. When Tammy told me about what she was doing, I was like, hey, this is great. Anything I can do to help? And I'm like, you know, if you need some machines, I can fatten you up. And it turns out they were going to be in the area going through there yesterday, which was perfect because Liz and I had concert tickets in Reading, Pennsylvania, which is only about an hour east of York, so it wasn't that much out of our way to go to York first for lunch, to see the Earth, Wind, and Fire alumni band. So we met up with Tammy and Matt, had a great lunch, they're awesome people, and then we went to go see the Earth, Wind, and Fire alumni band, which was a phenomenal show. I wholeheartedly recommend it if it comes to your town, or, well, it didn't come to our town, it was 3 hours of driving for us, but we didn't care because it's funk, and who doesn't love Earth, Wind, and Fire? But anyway, so that's what's been going on around here. I hope the singer video helped you guys out for putting together and adjusting the main and vertical shafts, but that's what I've got for you this week. Thank you. Oh, no, there's one more thing. Today, and the reason why this is getting shot so late, we did a house call over to our friends Karen and Jeff Wallstein. They live over in Neptune. Karen Karen was the one who got Liz and I to go to the quilting classes. Or she's the one that suggested the quilting classes at Mouse Creek Quilts that we took, and Karen's our quilting partner. Anyway, I had done some work on the 15-91 that had been, I believe, Jeff's grandmother's machine at one point in time. And it was having a mild issue with its upper thread tension unit. I took care of that while we were at the house. But she was having some issues with her featherweight. So we sat down at the kitchen table. We put big piece of cloth, heavy cloth down to protect the table and protect the machine. And together, Karen and I were doing some wrenching on it. As you can see here in this video, Karen putting in the process of putting things back together again. We had to pull the hook out, take the hook completely apart, and clean some schmoo out of there. But yeah, it was a fun time, and then we went out to dinner afterwards, and then ice cream after that. Now I am waddling. But anyway, that's what I've got for you this week. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next video.